Good morning. Welcome to worship on this Trinity Sunday, the first Sunday in June. Can you imagine? It's June already. Oh, it's going to be November again soon. Oh. Thank God we don't hand out tomatoes before worship. Few announcements for our life together, friends. We have our West Mill Creek Food Pantry items there. Always put those in the shopping cart up top here. Our adult education class we started today. We're studying the Apostles' Creed for the next several weeks. We meet 9 a.m. in the Sunset Room. Next week, we're looking at the second part, Jesus. Today, we looked at God the Father. Next week, we'll look at the Jesus. We have our food and fellowship today. And don't forget, there is the bake sale, all those wonderful items provided by Embracing Our Veterans. I hope you all stopped at an ATM and filled your pockets with cash so that you can buy wonderful things. And then if you can help us out with greeters or bringing a snack on the first Sunday of the month, that would be wonderful. Friends, on this Trinity Sunday, as we gather ourselves, let us do so with prayer. Would you pray with me? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, glory to you forever. Speaker, word, and breath of life, glory to you forever. Font of blessing, living water, flowing river, glory to you forever. Compassionate mother, beloved child, life-giving womb, glory to you forever. Sun, light, and burning ray, glory to you forever. Giver, gift, and always giving, glory to you forever. Lover, beloved, and love itself, glory to you forever. Rock, cornerstone, and temple, glory to you forever. Consuming fire, dividing sword, overpowering storm, glory to you forever. Rainbow of promise, ark of salvation, dove of peace, glory to you forever. God who was, God who is, and God who evermore shall be, glory to you forever. Almighty and ever-living God, you have given us grace by our confession of faith to acknowledge and worship your triune name in the majesty and the mystery of your unity. Keep us steadfast in this faith and worship, and bring us at last to see you in your eternal glory, one God, now and forever. Amen. Friends, join me in our call to worship this morning, which comes from Psalm 8. O Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have established, what are human beings that you are mindful of them, mortals that you care for them? You have given them dominion over the works of your hands, and you have put all things under their feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the sea. Friends, let's stand and join our voices together in our first song, For the Beauty of the Earth.
For the beauty of the earth,
for the glory of the skies, for the love which from our earth over and around us lies, Lord of all, to thee
Friends, please be seated. When our young disciples come up, we have a special musical piece today for Trinity Sunday. Wow. If we could, does everybody know this song, old camp song? My God is so great, so strong, and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do. The mountains are his, the rivers are his, the stars are his handiwork too. And then at the end, clap, clap. That's... Huh? Oh, my bad. I told Sue I'd be the biggest one to screw up here. So, let's play it again. We will play it. You will sing it. Don't forget to clap, clap. All right, one more time. Ready? My God is so great, so strong, and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do. Mountains are his, the rivers are his, the stars are his handiwork too. My God is so great, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God can. No. We're good. That was it. You can't improve on that. Staying for his special ovation. So you probably noticed these tiny little tinkle bells. These are the brand new set that we got that allows us to go up a whole octave, right? Yes. Whole octave. And so we get to go up to that really high Tinkerbell range. And fun little story, these are made right here in Pennsylvania. These are made by Malmark. Yes. And the competitor, Schulmerich. Their factory is literally right across the street. Fun little history on the bells, but made right here in PA. Plumsteadville? Plumsteadville, which has two factories and not much else. Just by the name, I can tell. Ooh, easy. Friends, let us join our hearts and our minds together and offer a confession and reflection of prayer to our God, seeking to hear and to know again of God's love and forgiveness of us. So let us pray. God of grace, love, and communion, we confess that we have failed to love you with all our heart, soul, and mind, and to love our neighbor as ourselves. We ignore your commandments. We stray from your way. We follow other gods. Have mercy on us. Forgive our sin and raise us to new life, that we may serve you faithfully and give honor to your holy name. Hear, O God, the prayers in silence of your people. Amen. God revealed God's amazing love to us in Jesus Christ, who was sent into the world to love us, to save us, to forgive us, not to condemn us. Hold on to this truth and be at peace. Amen. Friends, our scripture lessons today come from Paul's second letter to the church in Corinth and also from the Gospel of Matthew. We start first with Paul. He says, "Finally, brothers and sisters, farewell. Put things in order. Listen to my appeal. Agree with one another. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the saints greet you. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you." We now hear the Great Commission from Matthew chapter 28. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw Jesus, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." Friends, would you pray with me for just one moment? Lord, speak to these people whom you love through your most imperfect vessel. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. There's that famous formula. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. That formula is what we think about, what we reflect on a day especially like today. On Trinity Sunday, the day when we stop and we start thinking again about God and God's ways. And we do it with easily the most complicated and complex and misunderstood and misunderstandable aspect of our Christian faith. The triune God. It's easy to say those words, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We say them often. They come up all the time in different aspects of our worship and our life together. When we were baptized as children or as younger adults, we said those words, and those words were said for us and said over us and through us. We say them almost every week in one way or another. You'd think, after thousands of years of making this confession that God is triune, that maybe we had finally figured it out. But alas, we have not. We try to wrap our heads around it. When you read the debates of the early church from centuries ago, this was one of the key factors, one of the big things that they were all talking about, trying to make sense out of it. A lot of ink and pages have been spilled trying to put something right here. But boy, is it tricky. How is it that we can say that God is one? There is only one God, and that God is full and complete and united, but that God shows up in three different persons. But those persons aren't separated. They're not different. They're the same, but they're also unique. Oh, boy. Sometimes we make it really, really complicated. Today we'll get into debates about things. Well, should we say Father? Well, if we say Father, then we're being awfully exclusive and we're forgetting about Mother. And there's a lot of scripture that shows us God revealing God's self to God's people in the language of mother. Jesus, for example, refers to himself as a mother hen. But isn't there a fear that if we only reduce God down to father or mother, that maybe we miss something? Maybe there's something there that we're just overlooking. Maybe we get far too exclusive in our language. So I would like to say that it might be easier for us to make sense out of how God operates in this triune way by kind of changing the formula a little bit. Probably in our heads, because boy, it would be awfully hard for me to say it in another way than the way I've been saying it forever, because I'm just a creature of habit. But in my head, I've come up with, I think, a solution. Instead of getting into those grand debates about father or mother and son or child, maybe instead we should say, God is the one who was and who is and who evermore shall be. God is. That's how God described God's self to Moses. Moses asked him in the book of Exodus, so when I go to the Israelites and I tell them your name, what is it that I should say? And Moses is probably expecting something, you know, more akin to Fred or Paul or Joe. Instead, God gives the great answer. When you go to the Israelites, I want you to say to them, I am. I am has sent you to us. I am. God exists. God is existence itself. God is. God is. Maybe we make it just that simple for ourselves. I know it saves me a lot of headaches if I just think about God as being. And I think about God as being, but also showing up to us in these other persons, coming to us and speaking to us like a parent, like a father or a mother. We could equally say a stepfather, a stepmother, adoptive father, adoptive mother, whatever language makes sense to us, because there is a parental aspect to God's love. All throughout Scripture, we get this understanding where the Israelites have an idea and they bring it to God and say, God, we got this great plan. And God says, that's cute, but it's not going to work. One of the famous examples of this is when the Israelites demand to have a king. They said, we want to have a king over us to govern us just like all the other nations of the world. And God says, that's cute, but do you know that that king is going to enslave you and overtax you and is going to enlist you in his armies for his wars? I will be your king. I will take care of you because I love you and I care about you, and I'll never do that to you. And the Israelites, because they're human, oh God, you're so silly. We've got to be like everybody else. And so God, in a very parental way, says, okay, go ahead. And I'll let you guess what happened to the Israelites. Everything God said, but big shocker. There are times in our own lives we think about how our parents did that. How our parents let us make those mistakes when we were so headstrong, we knew the answer. And they gave us the space. Really, they gave us grace and said, go ahead. Go ahead and figure it out. When we were on our trip, we were in a great little store that had, you know, all the really fancy knickknacks that you don't need but you have to buy. And they have this little wooden sign. And it said, oh my God, my mother was right about everything. I did not, however, buy that sign. Yeah, she was. And I didn't want that. It was still early in the trip and we just did not need to inflate that ego. God comes to us in a parental way. And so whatever language we are going to use to try to describe what that relationship looks like and how it works, that's fine. Because ultimately we are saying God is a parent to us. Sometimes God is a father to us. Sometimes God is a mother to us. Sometimes God is adoptive of us. All of that language works. And if we jump to the second side of that, God who was, God who is. We think about the Christ experience. We think about this big God, this God that we just sang about, that our God is so big, so strong, and so mighty. I had to think of the words. I didn't go to church camp, so I didn't know the song. Anyway, we think about this bigness of God, like reducing down into a person. You could spend your life trying to figure out how that works. Maybe we just accept that God did it, that God was fully present to us, to our forebears, in this person, Jesus. That God is still present to us in this person, Jesus, that he's still around with us. He's still here. We get to see him. We get to meet him, if no other place than at this table where he invites us to receive him. That God has become tangible in this one that we call son or child, whichever, again, language works for you, go ahead, because it's the same idea. And they both lift up these things for us. They make us think about the love of a parent for their child. It also reminds us that this one who was so great, who taught and who healed and who raised the dead, is also the very same one who overcame resurrection. But there was that really important part in his life when he was just like us. I mean, he was always just like us, but there's one part of the story that really helps to illuminate it, and that's the infancy. Our God, so big, who called forth the creation, who gave mountains their shape and gave depth to the oceans and called all the beings out, is the very same one who laid helpless and crying in a manger. That helps us to be able to relate to the experience of God and for God to relate to our experience of having been in that same position at a point in our lives. And so we get to learn that God isn't just some distant actor, some lever puller who's out there just making decisions, but this is the same God who is intimately part of our world, part of our history, who still comes to us and who still speaks to us, who prays for us, who cares about us, who loves us, who wants nothing more than to be loved by us. That helps us maybe to wrap our heads around a little bit this big mystery of what we call God. That this is the God who is, who still exists. It's not that God was, and that's it, that's the end of the story. God used to be. The Bible, then, when we read it, aren't just God's greatest hits from a generation ago. Or 10 generations ago. Instead, Scripture becomes for us this living document, this living testimony, these words, these books, these pages that just come out at us and we can see them coming alive in our world because we see the hand of Christ right in the midst of them. We hear his story. We hear him still speaking to us. If we jump to that last part, the God who evermore shall be, God who was, God who is, and God who evermore shall be, helps to remind our little minds that God is still at work. That the Bible, as much as it is a testimony of a living testimony, it does reflect a lot of historical circumstance, things that we don't live through. But it doesn't mean that God isn't still alive and present, isn't still here, isn't the one who will call all of the cosmos into its completion at the return of Jesus. The one who still speaks to us and still grabs hold of us and still pushes us. We could think of this in the terms of the Spirit. The Spirit, that force, that thing that we just can't put our finger on. We've been watching in our house the Star Wars series. And I'm very excited about this, because if you know me, you know I love Star Wars. And I'll tell you what, I did not need to take her at gunpoint and duct tape her to the chair. She volunteered. I lost my breath. I nearly passed out. I was shocked. But we're watching this, and she's got questions, understandably so. She's not as big of a dork as I am, so I get it. There's this discussion of the Force. And she asked the one time, she goes, so tell me how this works. And I explain the midichlorians and how it all works and such in the Star Wars world. She's like, wow, that sounds like a lot like, kind of like the Holy Spirit. Okay. Interesting. Yes, maybe. I don't think George Lucas was thinking Christian theology when he was writing it, but let's go with it. In a sense, we get that. There's this presence of God that we just can't wrap our heads around. It's what we talked about last week in Pentecost, that God is just there. And it's this still small voice. It's this feeling in our gut. It's this fluttering in our hearts. It's this thought that just comes to our minds and we can't make sense out of it. That is God who evermore shall be. We are confessing when we say that God was the God of Israel and Jacob and all the others. And God is the one in Jesus who also came at a time and is still with us. But this is also the same God who continues to exist and push us and nurture us and nudge us and come to us and speak to us and love us and embrace us and inspire us and do all these things that we just can't figure out where it's coming from. And this is the God who always more shall reign. When we make these statements about God and God's ways, what we're really getting at is that God is complete. God is whole. God is full. God doesn't need us. God doesn't need the creation, but God desires us and desires the creation, desires to have relationship with us and is always trying to reach out to us. The triunity of God reveals, one on one hand, that God is complete, but also all the ways that God is reaching to us. God speaking through the prophets like Jeremiah and Isaiah and Moses. God also coming to us so we can see God and we can know God and we can interact with God in the person Jesus. And God reaching out to us still, even when we don't see Jesus anymore, but reaching out to us and grabbing hold of us by God's own Spirit and saying, I'm still here, I still love you. It's that feeling when we read Scripture, when we come to the table, when we receive or when we witness baptism, when we see relationships come back together, when we see forgiveness being done, when we see mercy being done, we see the Spirit at work. And it tells us God is still here. It can be very easy for us in our world full of technology and science to try to ignore God. We were just talking about this morning. It's so fascinating how this works. Science is, for me, one of the languages of God. It's how God talks to us in one way. It's how God shows us the minutiae of what God is up to. God shows us this perfection. God shows us this balance. God shows us a creation that is thriving and working together. How one thing relies on the other and relies on the other and relies on the other. Science is not opposed to religion, maybe some scientists, but science in general is not. It explained to us how our world works and little things. And for me, when I learn more about science, when I learn more about especially how the human body works, this ain't no accident. You can't tell me that a random arrangement of atoms found the perfection that is the human body. Some of us have more perfect bodies than others, of course. I knew that joke would get a laugh. But the way that all of our systems interact together, the way that they communicate with each other, the way that one backs up the other. And yeah, we can see the fragility of our bodies. We can see the broken downness of our bodies, but we also see ways that our bodies work around things. And I'm sorry, that's not a random collection of atoms. Yeah, there's atoms there, but it's not just random. This is a God who is intimately involved in us and with us and for us and through us. So when I look at science, I see more evidence of our triune God reaching out to us and speaking to us and revealing God's self to us. Not in some distant way, not in some dry textbook way, but in a deeply personal way. Maybe we'll never be able to completely wrap our heads around the mystery of the triune God. Maybe we'll never be able to completely understand exactly how God is revealed in three persons, but is still one and the same God that holds the same substance with all the others. It's just, you know, it is. Maybe we can't do that. Maybe we're not meant to do that. So maybe instead we need to go back to something that is very basic. Understand as God tells us that God is. God exists. God is existence itself. God is the one who always was and always is and always evermore shall be. God is. Amen. Friends, as I said before, if there's nowhere else that we can meet the risen Christ, it's here at his table, where he is the one who invites us. He invites us by his grace and by his great love for us. He invites us to come and to receive him into ourselves, to take all of him into us, to be united with him, because he loves us and wants to be near us. So friends, we are invited to this table. Not by our goodness, not by our evil, but by the love of God made known to us in Jesus Christ. My friends, let us pray. It is truly right and our greatest joy always and everywhere to give you thanks and praise, eternal and triune God. You spoke the world into being. Your word became flesh in Jesus Christ. By your Spirit, you made us your people. When we were lost in sin, you found us, sending us your prophets and even your own child. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with choirs of angels, with all the faithful of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your name. You are holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Born of Mary, he came to dwell among us, full of grace and truth. He forgave our failures, healed our hurts, and gave himself in utter sacrifice for those whom he loved. After 3 days, you raised him from the dead, that we might never die. Remembering your gracious acts in Jesus Christ, we take from your creation this bread and this cup, and joyfully celebrate his dying and rising as we await the day of his coming. With thanksgiving, we offer our very selves to you, to be a living and holy sacrifice dedicated to your service. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and cup, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share this feast, united in ministry in every place. As this is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in this world. Keep us faithful in your service until Christ comes in final victory, and we shall feast with all your saints in the joy of your eternal realm. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. As the Lord Jesus taught us, we are humble to pray. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We remember, friends, that on the night that Jesus was arrested, he was eating with his disciples in the upper room. He took bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it. He said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat." In a similar way, after the supper ended, pouring out the cup, he said, "This cup is sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins for you and for many. Do this in memory of me." We are assured that every time we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim the saving death of the Lord until he comes again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Will the elders please come forward? Friends, as you come forward, you're invited to come through the center aisle to receive the bread and then go out to either side aisle, which makes the most sense to you, to receive the cup. We have regular bread. We also have gluten-free. If you need that, just let Tom know when he gives it to you.
Thank you.
My friends, let us pray. Holy Spirit, you have filled us with your life. Christ, our Savior, you have embraced us in your love. God, our parent, you have fed us with your grace. Now send us out into your beloved world to share your life, your love, and your grace with all. Blessing and honor and glory to you forever, holy, holy, holy Lord. Amen. Friends, let us stand and sing together our final song. Friends, go out from this place in the name of God. God who always was, and the God who always is, and the God who evermore shall be. Go out from this place, this presence, to go and serve our God. Amen.